Today's webinar, Global Human Development, Updates on the Changing Landscape and Georgetown University's Response, sponsored by the Georgetown University's Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Hay, Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Dr. Ann Van Dusen, Associate Professor here at Georgetown and Director of the MA in Global Human Development Program. So we're very glad to have a faculty member on the line today. To begin, I'd just like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access a replay of the webinar within 3 business days on our YouTube channel. To access, simply go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this could be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of those applications or simply join us via the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Dr. Van Dusen is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A portion of the presentation, and PowerPoint slides will be emailed to you afterwards. If you're having any technical difficulties, feel free to let me know by submitting those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Ann Van Dusen and turn it over to her.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ann Van Dusen. I am now the director of the Global Human Development Program here at Georgetown, which is a new program. Just a little bit of information about my own background. My training was as a sociologist, and my research interests were women and families in the Middle East. And it was really quite by chance that I got into the world of development and development assistance. I probably was heading down an academic track at a time that USAID was looking for social scientists who'd actually worked and lived in the developing world and were interested in helping to improve programs and to do better evaluations. So I joined AID thinking it clearly wasn't going to last more than 3, maybe even 2 years, and I stayed there for about 25. So I am happy to answer questions about the experience that I had at AID. When I left, I went to Save the Children, where I was the executive vice president. And in many ways, Save the Children and USAID are very much alike in terms of management structures, program areas, and of course, in many ways, they are very different. I have also worked with smaller NGOs, and I've advised foundations that are working in the development sphere, including corporate foundations and as well as private ones. And I have been teaching at Georgetown and also at SAIS for the last few years. So my career has clearly been in the development field, although that's certainly not where I thought I was going to go. And there's obviously a lesson there. When I talk with people about jobs in the development field and what you need to do to have a successful and satisfying career in development, there are 3 questions that keep coming up. First, are there any jobs in development these days? Second, do I need a professional degree if I really want to work in this field, that is an MPH or an MBA or something? And how do I get a job without experience? And how do I get experience without a job? And I thought it worth mentioning these because these come up so frequently. So the answer is yes, there are jobs in development. In fact, I am very bullish and optimistic. I think there are an increasing number of jobs in this area. Do you need a professional degree? No, not necessarily. I think that has a lot to do with the changes that are happening in the academic world, and we'll talk more about that. And then how do you get a job without experience or experience without a job? Well, I'm going to talk about that because it's something that is on a lot of people's mind. But I think just to jump to a couple of the conclusions that that I have reached about this whole field, and I hope will become obvious as we go through some of the background material, is first of all, working on development issues is less and less about working on foreign aid or development assistance. I couldn't say that 20 years ago, maybe even 10 years ago, but the whole nature of what it means to be working on development issues is shifting and shifting rapidly. And the second area is basically the old paradigm was you go to school for the knowledge and then you get your skills on the job. And that's the way lots of programs have been set up. But I think a lot of programs now are realizing that that's not the most efficient way to develop skills. And more schools, including Georgetown, are actually bringing skills development into the classroom and onto campus so that the goal is that students leaving not only have deep knowledge about a particular area, but have some of the skills that they need to advance. So we'll come back to those conclusions in a little bit. I wanted just to start by going over some of the major trends as I see them that are changing the landscape for people interested in working in development. And I'm just going to go through a few of these bullet areas. So obviously there has been a lot of progress in reducing poverty, and there are fewer and fewer desperately poor people. So let me just slip ahead. So as you can see from this chart, with the exception of Africa, which now poverty rates are coming down, but it's taken longer, there has been a dramatic decrease in the number of people living on a dollar a day or less. Another way of looking at it is this, which is showing the trend, the downward trends in population earning less than $1.25 a day, which is the UN definition of severe poverty. So in all cases, the trends are going down. And then there are related trends that go with the decreasing poverty and improving livelihoods. So life expectancy is generally going up, and that has a lot to do with health conditions, environmental conditions. The one exception that you'll see in this slide is sub-Saharan Africa, and that has a lot to do, sadly, with the HIV AIDS epidemic. But overall, life expectancy is up, and infant mortality rates are declining dramatically. I was the head of AID's Office of Health in the mid-1980s, and the at that time, infant mortality rates in most of the countries where AID was working was at roughly 100 per thousand, which is, you know, 1 in 10 child doesn't make it past the first birthday. So to have it now down to under 40, 38 exactly, is really a remarkable achievement. So clearly there has been a lot of progress, and that changes the nature of what development means. But related to that, and I think this is really critical, most poor people in the world today are living in pockets of poverty rather than in absolutely poor countries. And so often these pockets of poverty are actually in middle-income countries or even wealthy states. And I'll just show you one chart that is very interesting. So the blue line is lower-income countries. And this is measuring the percent of world poverty that occurs in those countries. The red line is lower middle-income countries, the Indias, the Brazils. And what you see is by far most poor people are actually living in lower middle-income countries. And that will continue for the next 20 years. What that says to me is that we really need to learn how to address those pockets, whether it's slums or it's rural areas or it's particular population groups. And the way we address those issues might be very much the same whether you're talking about Mumbai or you're talking about the Central Valley of California. So one of the convergences that I see, and I hope we'll be able to talk about this later, is that the skills that are being developed to work on issues in very poor countries are also the skills that are needed to work on pockets of poverty in wealthy and middle-income countries as well. A third trend that I think is profoundly changing the way we look at careers, jobs in the development sector, is that ODA, Official Development Assistance, that is foreign aid, is now no more than 25% of all the resources going into poor countries. Two decades ago, it probably was well up above 60%. But now, foreign direct investment is more than four times the amount of foreign aid going into poor countries. And even worker remittances and compensations that flow back to poor countries are more than double the amount of official aid. So a lot of the resources that are coming into developing countries are actually not coming through official donor channels. They're coming through corporate channels, private investment. And that's also changing the dynamic of how problems get addressed. There are, of course, also many new donors who are bringing new ideas, new resources. Some of it is competitive, but many of the countries that the U.S. Helped over the last 40 years now have aid programs of their own. South Korea, India, Thailand, Indonesia, certainly China it has a major program. So what you have is a growing marketplace of official donors that are competing for skills, new ideas, and that also, I think, is bringing a vibrancy to the area. But it's not just the official donors. I've talked about countries and official aid. The private donors, the Gates Foundations, the corporate foundations are also playing an increasing role in leveraging new resources, bringing new ideas, and they don't necessarily even work very closely with official donors. So you have a marketplace resources and ideas that are both new countries that are offering assistance, private entities, certainly venture philanthropists are playing a major role as well. So it's actually a very exciting time to be working in the development arena. Another let me just show you one trend that shows you what's been happening with net private capital flows to developing countries. Obviously, you see the economic downturn of a couple of years ago, but it's popped right back up again. The investment, I imagine, will continue to flow into the developing world. Technology and innovation. I know you've had other webinars that have addressed this issue, but in the area of development, you just cannot underestimate the importance that new technologies, new ways of doing things, are actually breaking log jams and changing the whole dynamic for addressing development problems. So I've just got a slide. There are new tools, mobile technologies. I think people understand that in many ways, almost every region is ahead of America in terms of the application of mobile technologies, whether it's mobile banking or using mobile technologies to move administrative data, doing censuses and things of that nature. It's changing the way information and resources are moved. But there's a lot that's happening in robotics, in nanotechnology, exploring alternative energy sources. This is a very big area for development and development thinkers. There are a lot of new tools. I think there's been a lot of attention to cook stoves and the role that improved cook stoves can play in reducing energy costs, improving indoor pollution, improving the lives of women who otherwise have to go and gather the wood for traditional cook stoves. Same thing in the area of rapid diagnostics. When I was the head of AIDS Office of Health, it didn't exist. Blood would be drawn, and then maybe 3 weeks later you'd get a report back which may or may not have been accurate, and there was hardly the best way to respond to outbreaks of diseases. And it certainly held everyone back in the early days of the HIV epidemic when it was difficult to diagnose the incidence. But it's not just things. There are new approaches that are really also changing the way people think about development. So new financing schemes. Now, in the area of health, there are, for instance, something that's called advanced purchase commitments, where one of the problems that that have been faced is large pharmaceutical companies were reluctant to invest R&D in some of the diseases of the poor countries because there was no way to recoup their R&D costs. And so places like AID and the Gates Foundation and UNICEF have basically made an advanced market commitment which said basically if you develop this vaccine that is needed for a predominantly poor population, we will agree to buy a certain amount of the product, which has in fact encouraged companies to actually invest the time and the resources to do those things. So, and you hear a lot now about grand challenges where seems to me every government agency and almost every foundation is basically putting out a call for new ideas. So it's a very exciting time to be thinking about how different ways of breaking some of the bottlenecks of development. Now, it is true that there are some some things that make this area difficult, and difficult for people from the U.S. who want to break into this area. One of them is basically a success story in its own right. Developing countries are creating their own professionals, and there are more and more college and graduate school graduates who are working in these, who are from and working in the countries that traditionally are in the developing world. And in fact, many of these professionals were actually trained at Georgetown and other U.S. universities. So it it becomes a challenge for how people from outside the country distinguish themselves and develop the skills that that allow them to compete with professionals in the country. A second issue that maybe will go away sometime, but certainly hasn't, is that that conflict and emergencies continue to disrupt economic and social progress. I just got a couple of charts to show you some of the interesting trends. This particular chart shows trends in armed conflict, which shows in terms of the shows a decrease after 1991, basically after the end of the Soviet era. But if you look at sort of the consequences for human populations, what you see is, in fact, a huge growth in the number of refugees and displaced populations. And, you know, that continues to be a problem. So, you know, I think the challenge, or one of the challenges for people working in the development sphere is how do you do what you can to avoid or conflict or reduce the likelihood of the outbreak of conflict, and then what do you do to mitigate, and how do you put countries and communities back on a positive track? So that leads me to what are some of the skills that that are useful now to compete successfully in the development sphere. One is clearly languages, and being able to communicate in several languages is an enormous advantage. A second area is basically overseas work and living experience. You know, I think through overseas education opportunities, through programs like Peace Corps, through other internships, a lot of people are gaining some of those experience, but I know that employers look for that. They want to know that people can function in a variety of settings. I think another thing that employers really are looking for is the ability to work in teams. That's one thing. We've seen a lot of that emphasized in businesses here in the U.S., but also working in cross-cultural teams. And in teams where you may not be the leader, but how do you learn to understand and value what different perspectives bring to a problem area? And, you know, that leads to another area, which is basically some cultural sensitivity, understanding cultural cues, understanding leadership styles, and understanding your own leadership style. These don't look These last two don't particularly look unique to development, and really they're not. But I think it's become increasingly clear that without these kinds of skills and understandings, it's really hard to be effective. So I said at the beginning, I'm very bullish on development and jobs in development, and I am. Where are the development jobs today? Well, there are still some among the official donors. That would be in the U.S., USAID, the Millennium Challenge Corporation, certainly the World Bank, the regional development banks, the UN system, the organizations that dominated the development landscape over the last 40 years are still hiring, and they're not going out of business, so they are still there. Non-governmental organizations, both international organizations like Save the Children, and local organizations like BRAC, for instance, are playing an increasing role in development work, and not just as implementers of other donors' good ideas, but NGOs have their own place at the table, and in the international meetings on everything from environment and climate to women, the NGOs basically have their own meetings and are their own play a very active role in shaping the agendas going forward. So, I think there are many opportunities in the traditional international NGOs and increasingly in domestic NGOs as well. I think a third area are the think tanks, something that has gone largely unnoticed is that in addition to the ones that we would normally think of, the Brookings and the CSIS and the Center for Global Development, and you can name those, there are hundreds of think tanks in the developing world that, and there's been a very interesting effort to basically catalog their skills and their skill deficit areas, but foundations here are very interested in strengthening the role that those think tanks play because they may have much more direct access to influencing government policies than would an international think tank. So that is, I think, a growing area. Advocacy organizations as well. It's not for everyone, but if you think about the whole confluence of development dialogue, advocacy organizations play a critical role in not only as a watchdog, but in raising issues that otherwise don't get to the attention of policymakers. So everybody knows about the role that Human Rights Watch or Oxfam play, but there are, or Transparency International, those are some of the big ones, but there are lots of advocacy organizations that play a major role. Foundations, both the private foundations such as Gates and the corporate foundations that I can't think of any of the major corporate foundations, corporations that don't have foundations that are making major investments in programming in the developing world, and I think that's one of the fastest growing areas for jobs and for support for activities. And last but not least, are corporations, not the CSR arm, but corporations, and for obvious reasons, You know, I listened to a talk recently that said today 30% of world trade is involves the developing countries, but by 2050, 70% of world trade will really be with and about what we now call developing countries. And corporations get it. They know they need to understand and invest in the countries that are going to be their customers, that are where they now or will source materials, where they will be getting their employees. So one of the interesting trends that I see is that it's the strategic planning offices of some major international businesses that are seeking out people with specific development skills. And in fact, we had a meeting with someone from Coca-Cola recently who said, you know, we feel like we're building our own aid agency because we need people who know about water, who know about community development, who know about health. We need them because we need to factor that into our own planning. If you look at this list, you can see why, to me, it seems that the whole field is opening up. And it has certainly affected the way we have approached designing the Global Human Development Program here at Georgetown. It is a new program. Our first class just arrived a couple of months ago, so they are moving into final exams shortly. You can appreciate the tension here. But the idea behind this program was to develop a skills-based graduate program for people who want to stay in the development field. And most of them actually have already spent 2 or 3 years working either because of Peace Corps or working with NGOs, working in the development field. And they recognized that they needed more more skills, more training, if they were going to continue to be successful. So we built this program around the proposition of what do you need to know and what do you need to be able to do to really make it in the development world in the 21st century. And I should say, just going back to this chart of where the jobs are, it might have been one time that you say, oh, well, I want to work in a bilateral agency, and you could expect to be there for your career. That just isn't the case. And I think our students know that they're going to move around. They're going to have to move around. They may spend a couple of years with AID. They might go to a foundation. They might work for a company for a while. They might work for themselves for a while. Change is sort of the constant for them. They know that their career is going to involve moving around among organizations. So we've set up a number of learning goals for the program. And clearly, just because we are increasing our focus on skills doesn't mean we are abandoning the knowledge element. Students have to understand the economic, political, and social dimensions of development practice. They also need a lot of substantive and analytic expertise, and they need to be proficient in both quantitative and qualitative techniques. Increasingly, employers want to know that that even if you're not an econometrician, you're not afraid of numbers, and you are willing to dig in and see you know, whether the numbers make sense. So having a questioning mind and maybe even a little skeptical mind about some of the analytic tools that are out there is helpful. We do have a number of very development-specific courses that all of the students take, whether it's in strategy and program design, budgeting, management, financing, monitoring and evaluation. In many programs, these would be sort of electives that students could take or not take. This program has sort of flipped things around and said, there are some core skills that you need, and then with your electives, we expect you to dig in and learn a fair amount about health or education or social enterprise. And I'll come back to the adapting and thriving in diverse organizational and cultural settings, because we approach this with the sense that some of this can be taught. And so we are trying a variety of things to get across these ideas. So I'll come back to that. But basically, this is a two-year full-time program, 16 courses. It's very structured. There are 10 core courses, and then the students have six electives. All of the students are required to go overseas to work with a development program or organization in the summer between their first and second year. I'll show you some of the organizations that have said, yes, we would like to take your students between the 2 years. But that goes to the point of how do you gain additional experience. I think programs like this one try to bring that experience back into the program so that students leave here with not only a lot of substantive knowledge, but a lot of the skills as well. So just a quick look at the core, and I'm going to be wrapping up soon because I'm very interested in your questions. The core courses, they're the inevitable economics of development. Politics and religion and culture, I don't know whether development programs 20 years ago would have focused on religion and culture, but as we look at the Middle East or we look at Nigeria, you look anywhere, you can't ignore the cultural dimension of the economic and social change. As I said earlier, everyone has got to come out of here being pretty comfortable with quantitative and qualitative analysis, and at a minimum, not afraid of numbers and not afraid to challenge them. We do a course on strategy, project design, budgeting, and accounting. Basically, you know, suppose you landed as a project officer. These are things that you need to know. And it's hard to cram it into one course, but we're trying. We have a course on evaluation, which is critical whether you're working for a donor agency, an NGO, or a company. Everybody is insisting on tracking results, understanding results, making sure that people actually are understanding the impact of the investments that are being made. We have a course on financing that everybody takes, critical especially with this expanding universe of actors in the development space. A course on innovation and technology, and this again would in most programs would be an elective, but the changes that technology is driving in development are absolutely central to understanding where the field is going. And more than that, we want students to be able to think of themselves as innovators. And so we are exploring working with design organizations and certainly working with Ashoka and other social entrepreneurial organizations to get students, whether they're interested in business or not, to begin to think about different ways of tackling problems. Management, this is one of the areas that most frequently gets ignored at the graduate school level, and we all need to sort of teach ourselves, but we are really going to try and give the students a good grounding on management techniques and management issues. Coming in, they all had Myers-Briggs tests, so they start out understanding something about leadership styles and their own leadership style, but we will go very much further in that. And then finally, we will have, and this is typical of a lot of graduate programs, a policy and practice development where teams of students will actually function as advisors to client organizations, and they will actually do a client engagement project as sort of the final part of their program. So as I said, what we've done here at Georgetown is flip things around and bring into the core program those skill areas and knowledge areas, and then have the students with the specializations go into particular sectors and get enough depth that that they might get a published paper. They certainly will get a summer work experience. They will build some understanding, credibility in these fields. So social enterprise probably won't surprise many of you that this is the most popular area. A lot of students are very concerned about sustainability and understand that development that rests almost entirely on outside donor assistance is not anything that can be sustained. So there's a lot of interest in the role that social enterprises and social impact investing can play, both here at the School of Foreign Service and in the McDonough School of Business. So we actually have a joint program where students from both programs specialize in this area. Public sector and public sector reform is a major issue, and this is one of the areas where I do think you see a convergence between the issues that developing countries are facing and the issues we're facing right here, whether it's pensions or health insurance or corruption. These are some of the big challenges facing countries, even as their governments become more capable and their civil society become more engaged. So this is an area that is of particular attention. Education and human capital, and especially looking at the link between education and jobs and education and migration, is an area that is very interesting to our students. Food, agriculture, and more particularly rural livelihoods. The world has become increasingly urban, but there needs to be a rural base to support it. And so a lot of the question is, how do you build and maintain a viable rural infrastructure and rural communities? So there's especially students who have worked in rural areas are really challenged by that question. Global health, it's probably internationally the biggest area for donor investment. Even here, the trends are changing. As you saw from the chart on infant mortality, a lot of the communicable diseases that concerned us 30 years ago are becoming under control. I can't say that for HIV, but there are some promising interventions. But increasingly, global health is going to concern itself with what's being called the non-communicable diseases, which are, you know, the diseases of aging, the diseases of risk behaviors, the diseases that we associate mainly with more wealthy countries. Diabetes, actually, I think probably diabetes is the single largest cause of death in India right now. So you're seeing convergence in some of the health challenges. Climate and the environment, it's very difficult to talk about sustainable development without focusing on climate and the environment. And then, as I think, as alums you all know, there are certificates that our students can take through other Georgetown programs. So there's a very strong program in refugees and emergencies, and a number of students are very interested in not only emergency response, but how, after an emergency, programs can be put together that move a community and a country more quickly back to some sort of normalcy. There's an international business diplomacy certificate. Then there are regional studies concentrations as well. There's Arab studies, Asian studies. There's, I don't see African studies here, but Africa has just started a certificate. So there is the possibility that instead of focusing in a sector, students can focus on a region. Although, to be honest, right now, this first group is almost entirely focused on one of these sector specializations. So I mentioned before that the students go overseas between the first and second year, and we feel so strongly about this that we are raising the money to cover the cost for them to do that. So they will be working in a project that basically helps them expand their experiences, test out their interests, and sort of hone their career objectives. This is pretty well current, but the partner group list grows all the time. And these are organizations from very traditional development organizations like Save the Children to or Catholic Relief Services to Coca-Cola to take an example. There are social enterprise groups here like Ashoka and Echoing Green. There are emergency organizations like International Medical Corps and Mercy Corps. But what they have in common is that they have a commitment to help produce this next generation of development workers, and have basically said that they will work with us to make sure that these students in the summer program get a good taste of what working in that type of an organization or setting would mean. And, you know, clearly they are also checking out the talent pool, and I suspect a number of the students will end up working for these or similar partners. So that is a little bit about the program. I mentioned that we're doing a lot of things to try and build skills. So we have a number of off-site retreats, including one that we did at the beginning of the year on ethics and development. And that's an issue that is sort of, it's integrated into almost every issue you tackle in development, and almost never do you talk about it. So this was really an attempt to go off-site and say, you know, it's okay, and in fact, you've got to think about what you do when you see behaviors that are uncomfortable for you, or what do you do when you become sort of trapped in a situation of corruption or bribery, or, you know, or even what is the role of a an outside change maker, and how do you, how do you square the ethical issues of coming in and basically introducing new ideas or new techniques that will disrupt the traditional way of doing things. So we've done that. We're going to do a development simulation exercise to give the students a chance to basically explore just how complicated most development situations actually are. We have done a leadership seminar as well, where people basically use the Myers-Briggs battery to understand leadership roles. We have had a very active speaker series, which obviously you can do in Washington. So actually tomorrow we have Rick Barton, who's the Assistant Secretary for Stabilization Operations at the UN. In this picture here, we have Joe Lampstein, who is the head of John Snow International, which is a health services firm that works all over the world. But we've had a wide range of speakers coming in, and instead of putting them in a big conference room at a podium, we've kept the event small, where the students can actually ask anything from how did you get into this field to would you advise me to go into it. So it's we are using these speakers as career advisors as well as for the very important knowledge that they bring. We're doing a number of skills clinics and workshops, and obviously the career Graduate Career Center does a wonderful job as well. I think I have spoken for much too long, but what Georgetown has tried to do here is take a hard look at the changes that are taking place in the development sphere and design a program that addresses those changes and hopefully sends out students who are really much better prepared to function and function effectively. I would just say that demand was huge. We advertised the program first in September a year ago, and we had 6 applications for every position, and I just did a quick look at the applications for this coming round. And it's the application process is even stronger. So I think there are many other ways of addressing this issue, but clearly I think Georgetown is doing something that people out there wanting to work in the development field think is really going to be useful. So I'm going to stop there and take any questions or comments that you have.
All right, everyone, please go ahead and submit any questions you have right now for Anne. And at this time, we don't have any questions, so I'll just give everyone a minute to enter them in.
Okay, well, while you're submitting, so this is what the class looks like, 9 men, 12 women. 5 international students, average of 4 years work experience. They've been in everywhere from Libya to Azerbaijan, and they all speak at least one foreign language. If you want to know more about the program or want to get in touch with me, here are ways that you can contact us if you don't have questions right now.
And we do actually have a question. How do you feel about the future of USAID funding for the international development in the next 5 years? For international development in the next 5 years?
I think it's not going to be a major growth area. I think the economic austerity that all government programs are going to face will certainly affect AID and the Millennium Challenge Corporation and U.S. contributions to But I don't think it is going to be as draconian as a lot of people think. And that's partly the nature of our system here. There are advocacy groups that will make it very difficult for Congress to cut funding for health or HIV/AIDS programs, or for agriculture programs. I think it will be less about major cuts in the funding, but I think there may be some program areas or some regional areas that will be, it is already the case that there is less and less happening in countries that were part of the former Soviet Union. And there has been relatively little done recently in Latin America. But honestly, South Asia, Africa, even some Asian countries, I would be very surprised if there is a major downturn.
Okay. Thank you, Anne. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about the, can you tell us about the kinds of preparation you most want to see from students who are coming into the program?
For students coming into the program?
Yeah.
We have made a conscious effort not to take students right out of undergraduate school. We want them to have had some experience, and especially some experience overseas, because this is so intensely focused on development and development issues. We want the students to know what they're getting into and to have actually thought through that this is what they want to do. Unlike other programs where you can come in and then maybe decide you'd rather go into business or something, this is really development, as one of my colleagues said, all development all the time. So having overseas experience is really important. Having a foreign language, or if not that, enough training in a language that over the time that that the person is here, they can develop competency. Now, a lot of our students, as the slide showed, already had a language, and they're taking advantage of Georgetown's amazing language programs to take a second language. But as you know, it's having language and the ability to function in different languages is really critical. We have also asked that students have some background in economics, because coming in cold, having never seen a production function or something, would be pretty difficult. So we do ask that people have taken a macro or micro course and have had some statistics background. Now, to be honest, a number of students hadn't had that and basically used the summer before coming in to do online courses, which I think they found had helped. But I would say we are looking for people who have clearly thought about this hard and made a decision that this is the direction they want to go. And we judge that by the investments they've made in living, working overseas, in language, and in their volunteer and their interest areas as well.
Thank you so much. And I have one last question for you. We do have a couple, but one last question specifically about the differences in working for USAID and Save the Children, and what each of those, what challenges one might face in applying to those jobs.
Right. I said I would be happy to talk about it. So some of the things that are very similar, and it's worth thinking about as you think about applying to both places, they are both large, multi-sectoral, multinational organizations. So they have field offices around the world. They have staff who live around the world and rarely, if ever, come into headquarters. They have people who focus on a particular sector, whether it's health and agriculture, or a particular region, Africa specialists, whatever. And with that comes some of the tensions that you have in any large organization. So both Aid and Save the Children have a headquarters field thing going, where there's some sense that the one doesn't understand what the other has to put up with. There's also, and I've seen this in so many organizations, a slight tension between people who focus on a substantive area, health or education or agriculture, and people who take a regional approach. And you will see that, it's not World War III, but you do see that in both Save the Children and AID, and I dare say CARE or any other large organization like that. The difference, when I went to Save the Children, they asked me, have you worked with a board of directors? And my first reaction was, I had Congress as my board of directors, and I had to go up there a lot to talk and sell the program. So, I felt like I had had plenty of experience. But it is very different because in the government, there is an appropriation. You may have to spend a lot of time figuring out how you divide up the money, but you know it's there, and you know it's there for fairly early on. With Save the Children and with lots of private organizations, you start out the year with a budget that has holes in it. And so there is much, whether you're a technical officer or a senior manager, focusing on the fundraising is something that just is constantly on your mind, and it makes it very difficult to plan longer term projects, unless you get a multi-year grant. I think another really important issue is that Save the Children and increasingly all international NGOs are really very international in their staffing. So you have people from all over the world who are working in the headquarters, and the nature of teams are multicultural and international. And in Latin America, most of the offices actually function in Spanish, even for an American organization. That's not the case for USAID. As a government agency, they employ Americans. Now, there are foreign service nationals that work in their own country with AID, but the experience in Washington is really a U.S. workforce, and I would say that is a major difference between the two. So the issues would be, funding and the funding horizon, the multinational, multicultural element of a non-U.S. government agency. The two important ones.
Thank you so much, Dr. Van Dusen, for answering those questions. And I think some people might be emailing you afterwards with additional questions. But
great.
Thank you so much for your time.
Right.
And thank you, everyone, for joining us today and talking about this new program. Very fascinating.
Bye-bye.
Good day. Bye.